We're going to go ahead and get started. My name is Finney Curavilla, and I'm going to be moderating this very special debate that we're going to have this morning on Christians voting and Christian engagement in politics. Just to give a brief introduction, so for those who are new, this is the Society for the Two Tasks. We're a group that we meet every Saturday during the school year on the Harvard campus. The name comes from a speech that was given by Charles Malik in 1980 at Wheaton College, where he argued the church had two tasks set before it, saving the soul and saving the mind. He also argued that the church had generally failed in the latter task. And so we in our group strive to save the soul by engaging in study and discussion of a wide variety of topics relating to scripture, apologetics, historic theology, world religion, secular critiques of Christianity, and the claims of Jesus. And our meetings are open to everyone. If you're not on the list, I'd love to have you on that. So we're going to have a discussion, as I mentioned, on voting and Christian engagement in politics. We're going to begin by playing a short 5-minute clip from NPR, and this will hopefully frame our discussion.
For conservative Christians, religious and political beliefs often go together. Some say their faith obligates them to support one candidate over another. But that's not so clear-cut in this year's presidential race. In fact, people who say faith is important to them don't show strong support for either Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton. As NPR's Tom Jelton reports, the race has some conservative Christians wondering whether faith and politics should be so tightly connected.
50 years ago, it was liberals who mixed religion and politics. Church leaders, black and white, were in the forefront of the civil rights movement. Conservative Christians first took a big interest in politics in 1980, supporting Ronald Reagan. From then on, they aligned with the Republican Party. Evangelical leader Russell Moore recalls a religious right group passing out voting guides at his church, outlining the Christian position on various issues.
And even as a teenager, I could recognize that the issues chosen just happened to be the same as that year's talking points from the Republican National Committee.
Moore, who heads the Southern Baptist Ethics and Religious Liberty Commission, said this last week in a lecture he titled, "Can the Religious Right Be Saved?" Christian political outreach, he recalled, had gone beyond simple matters of faith.
Why was there a Christian position outlined on congressional term limits and a balanced budget amendment and the line item veto?
Though a conservative himself, Moore says some Christians are again taking their pro-Republican position too far by lining up behind Donald Trump. He cites Trump's questionable behavior and divisive rhetoric. Some pro-Trump evangelicals see him as the lesser evil in this election, figuring he'd be more likely than Hillary Clinton to appoint Supreme Court justices who will restrict abortion and defend religious freedom. The popular Christian author Eric Metaxas, writing in the Wall Street Journal, said, "Not voting will have a consequence. God," Metaxas said, "will not hold us guiltless." But that suggestion that God wants Christians to vote a certain way got Metaxas in hot water with other Christian leaders.
I have been horribly misunderstood, and it's really damaged my reputation just because I put this thing out there. And sometimes you're too clever by half, which is a nice way of saying you're stupid. When I put that out there, I didn't realize most people aren't going to get the joke, so to speak.
Metaxas said he was actually quoting the German theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who said, "God would not hold Germans guiltless for appeasing Hitler. Silence in the face of evil is itself evil."
And what he meant by that, the point of the quote, is that you can't say, "Oh, I'm not going to vote." You have to make a sober, difficult choice because people are depending on you.
Well, do you think God favors one candidate over the other?
Well, you know, when you put it that way, it can be misleading.
God does have a will for this country, Metaxas argues, but works in mysterious ways. A recent survey found 72% of white evangelical Protestants think immoral behavior does not disqualify someone from holding public office. 5 years ago, only 30% said that. But there are conservative Christians for whom this year's choice has them reassessing the connection between their faith and their politics. Jennifer Sarver is a lifelong Republican who served under President George W. Bush. Now running a PR firm in Texas, Sarver is supporting Hillary Clinton, even while disagreeing with her on abortion. Some of her Christian friends are dismayed, but in a blog post that went viral, Sarver defended her position as a Christian.
I evangelized by trying to live my life in a way that would honor and respect my Savior. And I think that if more Christians live their life trying to walk in Jesus' footprints and not trying to tell people how to vote, we'd have a better society.
Indeed, there's one Bible verse that's getting a lot of attention this fall in pulpits around the country. It includes these words from Jesus.
He said, "My kingdom is not of this world."
Pastor Duke Kwan, preaching last week at Grace Meridian Hill Church in Washington, D.C., to a diverse urban congregation. His message, Jesus' teaching doesn't fit neatly in political categories.
Why should we be surprised when he doesn't just sign off on a whole party single platform? Why should we be surprised when someone that really follows Jesus might be a person that sort of confounds people, keeps them guessing, you don't seem to fit? And the answer can be, well, my Savior didn't fit either.
Kwan says Christians' faith should guide their politics, but in an interview, he clarifies, not so much in elections, but in mundane ways, on their own block, in their own neighborhoods. Moreover, even if Scripture suggests a correct Christian position on one issue, the sanctity of life, for example, what about the Christian position on other issues, caring for the poor, the foreigner, or the planet?
There's a sense in which you ought to be split across different party platforms and different candidates because, hey, well, these four issues I find embodied in this person and these two in this other person.
All of which means the idea that evangelical Christians should base their voting on their faith is more challenging than it once seemed. Tom Gelton, NPR News.
So with that, I'd like to introduce Josh Good. Josh Good is a personal friend of mine. He currently serves as the program director and team leader for the Faith, Work, and Economics program at Kern. Prior to joining the foundation in 2015, Josh managed the Values and Capitalism Initiative at the American Enterprise Institute, or the AEI, working closely for 3 years with the Kern Foundation's team. Prior to AEI, Josh spent 4 years as a consultant at ICF International, where he worked on responsible fatherhood and healthy marriage initiatives. He also worked on a national public-private partnership that supported collaborations between congregations and businesses to serve ex-prisoners. Josh holds a bachelor's degree in history from Covenant College and a master's degree in Christianity and culture from Harvard University. His work has been published in the National Review, the Weekly Standard, The Hill, The Washington Times, Patheos, World Magazine, and Capital Commentary. As I mentioned, he's a personal friend. We actually overlapped in graduate school. He was here from 01 to 03, which were also years of mine, where we actually both graduated the same year. And his wife, Becca, was InterVarsity staff here. And actually, several of us, Josh, Becca, and I went to India for an engagement party that I had when I was about to get married. Josh and Becca and their three children live in Wisconsin. And Josh actually also told me that he TA'd a class in this very room, so appropriate for our current location. I often refer to Josh as a walking encyclopedia. He probably knows more about the intersection of religion and politics than any person that I've ever met, and I'm fascinated to hear what he's going to be saying. He's going to be speaking in favor of Christians voting and in favor of political engagement. Speaking against Christians voting is going to be Matthew Milioni, seated here on the left. Matthew was raised in California and Oregon. Notably, he and his wife spent some time actually as gang members with the skinheads, but eventually he gave his life to the Lord, but came to the conviction that the modern church was broken. He came to the conviction of the historic church, by which I mean the church in the first three centuries had a more accurate expression of biblical faith. So because of that conviction, Matthew has spent many years calling the church to repent from what he will contend is a distorted gospel to an authentic vision of Jesus' teachings. He's an excellent speaker, and he and his wife and their 10 children live in the Boston area. So with that, we're going to begin. We're going to allow both Josh and Matthew to have opening statements of about 15 minutes. Then we'll do questions back and forth. I'll help moderate, and then we'll take questions from anyone in the audience. So with that, Matthew, please begin.
Yeah, well, thank you. It's good to be here with you all today. I wanted to start by kind of an analysis. If you go with me back to 1980, in Lynchburg, Virginia, a man by the name of Jerry Falwell introduced the platform of the moral majority to a congregation there. And when Jerry Falwell introduced his plans for the moral majority, he had an idea about how to put the country back on track, how to get America back to her Christian roots. The stated platform from Mr. Falwell back in 1980 was that they would end abortion through political influence, they would return school prayer, they would restore traditional gender roles in society, they would defeat the Equal Rights Amendment, they would quash gay rights, and overall they would return America to her Christian heritage. So that was in 1980, and the moral majority became an influential political force in America throughout the 80s and into the 90s. When Michael Harris this year, who was at the first national meeting of the moral majority with Mr. Falwell and Tim LaHaye and many other speakers, he remembered those meetings and the original intent of the moral majority back in the 80s. And in an interview this year, he said that if you had gone to us back in 1980 and told us that American evangelicals would be supporting a candidate like Donald Trump, his quote was, "We would have told you it will be a cold day in hell before we do that." The whole notion of the moral majority and the evangelical political right was that there was a call to morality, a clarion call to return America to her moral heritage. Now, whether or not what that moral heritage is, I think, debatable. It's hard to imagine, looking back through American history and politics, where we're supposed to reset the clock on American morality. Is it the Puritans who came to America with a divine right to take over whatever land happened to be here? Was it the Golden Triangle? Was it labor suppression in the beginning of the part of the 20th century? Was it our various escapades through slavery? It's hard to imagine prohibition in the 30s where the moral period of American history is, but if we grant that there was a moral background, a moral heritage to America, we should ask whether or not the political influence of American evangelical political movements like the moral majority, were they successful? Where have we come now from 1980s moral majority institution to 2016, where many, especially white evangelicals, are doing exactly that? They're supporting a candidate like Donald Trump, or having to support a candidate like Hillary Clinton. And this is the crux of the issue. It's highlighted extremely well in today's current political environment. But it's things that a lot of us have been saying for a long time. John Yoder, all the way back in the 70s, 80s, was making points about our involvement in civil structures and where we should be and where we shouldn't and how we should be representing Christ to the world around us. So the critique is old. We're at the point now where Jerry Falwell Jr., the son, is shaking hands in a photo op with Donald Trump with an auspicious copy of Playboy over his shoulder. So it's really time to reassess American Christian involvement in politics and see whether or not we've done better or worse for the church and for the world around us by our participation in these events. What Barna tells us now in his latest 2016 study is that 73% of Americans still claim to be Christian in some form, whatever broad way that's defined. 31%, according to Mr. Barna, are practicing Christians, where they have gone to church in a regular interval. There's other defining ways to declare practicing Christian, but he has it at 31%. In the last decade, those that claim to be deeply spiritual, that's the quote from Barna, has dropped 21 points. Those that claim religious faith is very important to them has dropped 16 points, and those who claim that personal commitment to Jesus, they have a personal commitment to Jesus, has dropped 12 points in the last 10 years. We know that with the recent defeat of DOMA and the institution of gay marriage in the Supreme Court, that fight is lost. We know that there are still 700,000 abortions as of 2012, and the drop from the 80s is probably much more likely from access to birth control than a moral position in the United States. So where have we gotten, and what have we paid to get here? What is the evangelical impact on the gospel? The question is, and what I would like to advocate, is that we have to ask ourselves again, what is the gospel? What really does the gospel mean? What is the Christian church in America supposed to be representing? See, I would advocate that Jesus came as a king with all of the intended consequences of that terminology. A real king of a real nation with a real people, a real domain, a real law, and a real politic. And that he instituted those things for his people. And one of the novel things about the institution of this kingdom of Jesus is that it's international. Mr. Roth, in a book called Electing Not to Vote, makes a statement that if we abstain from the political process, we have the opportunity of displaying to both our children and the world that our primary allegiance is to the international people of Jesus rather than our own personal nation states. That we have concerns that are broader than the nation that we live, that we have a really eternal and international focus for the Church of Jesus Christ. And that fits with the calling of Jesus. See, you know, the people of Israel, they had called at one time under Samuel. They had said, we want a king like the nations. We want a king like the nations. And when Samuel wept over that, when he was distraught over that, God came to Samuel, the prophet, and said, what are you upset for? They haven't rejected you, they've rejected me. Well, a king was promised, and the Messiah was going to come. But when he came, everyone expected that he was going to bring this political upheaval, that he was going to change the stakes of the game, that he was going to reinstitute Jerusalem, that he was going to throw off the yoke of Rome. This is a consistent and perennial issue in the people around Jesus during his ministry. And again he disappoints even his own disciples in this regard. And what Jesus fixates instead of, so like take for example Herod, who we know had these horrendous oppressive tax policies. He's building the temple, and there's this horrendous tax issue going on. In fact, the Jews send delegates to Caesar twice during the reign of Herod complaining about the taxes. But where's Jesus on the comment? Where's Jesus' commentary on the situation? We don't have anything about it. We know that people are being oppressed. We know that the poor are being torn to pieces by Herod's oppressive regime. And instead of Jesus attacking Herod and the policies and trying to upset the order, what Jesus does is he looks at a person and he says, you take care of the poor. I'm not going to undo Herod's tax program. That's not my point. I'm going to tear at the root of evil in the individual in front of me. And that's how I'm going to change the world. And this is what's really at stake in difference between whether or not the church has a stake in politics, American or otherwise, or whether she's going to stay focused in her own national politics, which is the politics of Jesus. When we consider that question, what we come to very quickly is this confrontation between Romans 13 and the Sermon on the Mount. In Romans 13, we're told by Paul that the government's civil structures are, quote, ordained by God. They're the minister of God to reward good and to punish evil. And he talks about submitting to those powers. In Matthew 5, we have Jesus telling his disciples that they're required under his law to love their enemies. He said, you have heard it been said by them of old times, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemies. But I say unto you, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hatefully and despitefully use you. And he tells us why. That ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh the sun to rise on the evil and the good, and he sends rain on the just and the unjust. So there's a competing interest, right? As a disciple of Jesus, the Lord is saying, love your enemies. Do good to the wicked ones. That's how you're going to unset evil in your day, in your world, in your life. And then in Romans, we have Paul saying that that God has ordained governments with a sword, a valid sword, to reward good and to punish evil. So how do we reconcile these things? Well, the first thing we have to do is we have to put Romans 13 in context. Whatever is true of Romans in our life had to be true of Romans in Paul's life. And we can't forget that the sword bearer in Paul's day was Nero. Nero was the one that was legitimately bearing the sword in Paul's theological construct. And that same Nero was soon to decapitate the author of Romans 13. And to this authority that's going to cut his head off, Paul says they're not a terror to good works, that we should submit to the higher powers. It goes falls in line with rendering unto Caesar that which is Caesar and rendering unto God that which is God's. And he gives this function of the state. There's a way to understand this contrast that makes beautiful sense of both callings. The position is outlined it's outlined well in a book by Leonard Verdwin. There's statements about this notion all the way back in the early church. Irenaeus makes mention of it, Tertullian does. If I have time, I'll share some of those things. But the construct is this, that there are two great powers that God has marshaled in order to redeem mankind. There are two great spheres of authority on earth. And Mr. Verdwin labels them conserving grace on the one hand, that which is keeping things together, and redeeming grace on the other, that which is calling people into the kingdom of God. Now, both of these authorities, conserving and redeeming, are necessary for God to save men. And if we look at what those are, we start with conserving grace, which we can call this Romans 13 authority. And the function of the state, whether it's Nero or Saddam Hussein or George Bush or Hitler or Pharaoh or Nebuchadnezzar, whoever you're talking about, the function of state under God's administration is to keep society intact. This is an important paradigm. It's to keep society intact. So whether you live in Hitler's Germany or Pharaoh's Egypt or Obama's America or Mao's China, you can't steal from the market, you can't kill your neighbor, you can't rape women indiscriminately, there's these checks put on the passions of men to keep men from denigrating into the land of the animals, into the morality of animals. There's a check put on the passions of men to control them. And the currency of that system of authority, the currency of that system is coercion, the sword. That there's a force behind the state that says, you must do this or else. And that puts the fear of man into man because he doesn't fear God. Because the law is for the lawless, the Bible says. On the other hand, where we have redeeming grace, we have the gospel call. And the gospel call is the people of Jesus doing exactly what Jesus did in his day. They're going out wherever they are. And if they happen to be persecuted by the civil structure around them, it's underground. If they happen to not be, it's above ground. But in either case, the church is going out into society that's being held intact by the state. And they're sowing the gospel. And they're saying to people, we have a different way. There's a different society. There's a different nation under the kingship of Jesus Christ that has a whole different order. In our order, we don't have to have laws about not killing people because our king gave us a law about not being angry with our brother. We don't have to have laws about adultery because our king gave us a law about not lusting. And in our kingdom, we don't need those laws. There's a higher way for man to live. There's a new social order instituted by Jesus Christ that you are being called to. And by your own repentance of your sins and baptism into Jesus Christ, you're able to become a part of this new kingdom with a new king. You're able to transfer your allegiance out of those old systems and old structures of the world that had you bound, and the structures inside your very heart that have you bound into your own sin, you're able to cast those things off and join yourself with a new allegiance to the new King Jesus. And then the system repeats, and more disciples, and the gospel has spread. Now, which model has been more effective? Where do you feel like the influence of the American evangelical churches in society? When you walk around and when you talk to people on the streets or in your classrooms or wherever you happen to be in your workplace, what's the sentiment about where the church is at today from those that are not in the church? What I find, and I spend a lot of time talking to people, what I find is that people are so dismissive of the influence of American evangelicalism. That the critique of American evangelicalism is that they're white, opinionated bullies, self-centered, greedy. The irony is that, and that they want to control everyone. The irony is that this is the exact opposite original criticism of the Church of Jesus Christ. The original criticism from Rome and from heretics like Celsus was that what is wrong with you crazy Christians? You don't partake in our policies. You don't partake in our games. You don't partake in our society. You're not interested in the things that we're interested in. You're only interested in eternal things. You live these miserable lives and then you die and you serve this persecuted, crucified king. The Roman critique was, why aren't you one of us? Why don't you fit in? Why don't you belong in Roman civilization and society? And the critique today is exactly opposite. You want to control everyone. You want to force your morality down people's throats. So which one was more effective? If we look at the case of the first church that spreads all the way to Caesar's house, that upends the entire Roman world, before Constantine, Christianity is spread to all the quote-unquote barbarian nations. And the influence of the church culminates for three centuries until the gospel of Jesus is known in every part of the known empire. And the Christians are respected. You know, Tertullian says, at one point he says in an apology to the Romans who are criticizing him, he says, we take care of your poor, not our poor. We take care of your poor better than you. This is, and nobody argues with him. I mean, these are people that could have said, no, you don't, but they don't. That criticism is not rebuffed. The moral character and the way in which the Christians are dealing with, you know, that abortion was an issue in the early church. Where are we for time?
We're at 15 minutes.
Oh, we're at 15 times. I'll wrap up here. So that main concept of conserving and redeeming grace is a huge part of understanding the political nation of Jesus in the context of where we belong in the world of politics.
Thanks, Matthew. Josh, your opening statement, 15 minutes.
Well, thanks, Finney, for the honor of being here, and thanks so much to all of you for coming out on a Saturday. It's a bold thing coming out on a Saturday when you got reading to do and life to live, so really grateful for your presence. It's a huge honor, and, you know, I always think these kinds of things can be interesting or they can be boring, and the thing about our new lives in the beginning of the digital age is that, you know, you can YouTube just about anything, so you might as well, you know, if you want to, you can get all my stuff on YouTube, but it's much more interesting to have a real conversation. And I do have some opening thoughts about what you shared, Matthew. I think you said a lot of things that are true, and it'll be great to both come together around some of those things and with the goal of sharp and clear and wise thinking that makes us all better, clarifying distinctions as well. And you know, I think what we just saw on the screen about the character comment, I thought was very telling that it's moved from 72% of a priority just 5 years ago for the person you'd elect at the top is office and the highest and the office in the land down to 35% in 5 years. Something's off there. and that's probably justified about a particular candidate this time around. And what you shared about the passion to be a part of the new inaugural order that is the church in building out families and schools and a new society where we can display the reign of Christ as opposed to the reign of Caesar alone in the world for our neighbors to see and be stunned by is beautiful. I couldn't agree more. Love that. And it'll be great to get into that some today. Your comments about Jerry Falwell and his son this time around resonate deeply with me personally this time around because I think what we're seeing by the sort of older guard GOP establishment and the old guard religious right in coming around a particular candidate this time with such a, in my view, unthoughtful embrace of that candidate is doing real damage, particularly to those of us in the room and millennials and those who are part of the digital age generation, the one that's just getting started right now. It's all whacked. So it's a great time to be together today and to think together about what does it mean for Christians to be engaged in the public square? What does it mean for us as citizens, not only of heaven, as you so beautifully outlined, but also of this world, the city of man, to be wise and to be awake and to be alert and to exercise the great privilege that is ours, any of us, these last 7 decades, with the massive and unparalleled rise of democracy in the world. You know, you go back to the end of World War II, and how many democracies were there? Less than 30. How many are there today? 140. It's incredible what we're living through. We're living through, really, I think, the best time in human history. Like, in human history, the best time to be alive. There are some people who are seated in this audience who will probably live to be 118 years old. Maybe 120 years old. Healthcare is better than ever. Poverty is, globally speaking, better off than ever before. The rise of people between 1970 and today who are no longer extremely poor, the rise, it's incredible. You know, 2 billion people are no longer living in extreme poverty. People who were living in extreme poverty when our parents were our age. It's incredible. Why is that? Well, it's not just because of Christian charity. And it's not just because of do-gooders who have done good things in sub-Saharan Africa. It isn't. Remember that image of the woman with the distended belly on the front cover of National Geographic? Well, that's not the way it is anymore. I mean, there's still poverty. There's still extreme poverty in some parts of the world, and we need to keep working on that. But anybody who is awake to what has happened in the last 4 decades can tell you, I think if you're paying attention, that it's not charity that has lifted billions of people out of poverty, but it is instead other realities, like, for example, the fact that there is a system that is at work at night when we're sleeping. Somebody delivered cups to Dunkin' Donuts this morning at 4 a.m. with a truck. And isn't it great that we can go get a Dunkin' Donuts coffee right after this together and talk about some more things? And it's a styrofoam cup, and it's going to cost us $1.99. It's incredible, and it's hot. It's great. And, you know, the reality is that if we care about the poor, like you're describing, we need to care about a system that will help the poor to flourish. And that doesn't mean just inviting them into our church, although it's a great thing. And that doesn't mean just educating our own children, although that's a great thing. It doesn't mean just attempting to have them, you know, be part of the digital age and be part of the best university in the world, like this one. It doesn't mean that. It means more than that. It means entrepreneurship and globalization and free trade and property rights and the rule of law. And when those things are advanced in the world, people are lifted out of poverty in a way that is beautiful and glorious, and I dare say part of the kingdom of God advancing in the world. Because it just is. Now, it's not to say that material wealth is the solution to the kingdom of God advancing in the world, but God works through history. God works through the unfolding of history. And if you're paying attention, in my view, you know, to the neo-Calvinists, to the Kuyperians, if you're paying attention to just the story of our own little nation, it's amazing that no longer do we have a monarch ruling over us in dominance, in some of the verbiage that you use to describe, you know, Caesar and Nero and Hitler and Mao. We have a free country, and it's incredible, and it's a huge privilege to be a part of it. Because frankly, you know, most of human history didn't get to be a part of this grand experiment. You know, the vast majority of people are not like us. We're so lucky. We're so rich. And we have institutions that allow us every 4 years to elect a new president, and every 2 years to elect a new Congress, and every 6 years a new senators. It's amazing, this system. It's broken. It's the least bad system that I've ever seen. And it's exciting to be a small part of it. And you know what we get to do next Tuesday morning, if we want to? We get to vote. What a joy. What a joy. It may be complicated this time around to figure out who's at the top of the ticket. It is, actually, I think. So if you don't want to vote for one of those two candidates, don't. Vote for, write somebody in. Write in Finney Caruvala. Write in whoever you want to, you know. Or don't. Don't vote for that category if you can't make up your mind in good conscience. Fine. But vote for every other candidate. Vote for your mayor. Vote for your state senator. Vote for your attorney general. Vote for your congressman. You know, it's amazing, the privilege of voting. I am going to vote. And I'm pretty sure I'm going to pull the lever for one of those two candidates, and I won't tell you who. But I know it's not. I know who it's not, and that'll become pretty clear. You know, it is incredible that we're living through this moment, in my opinion, in this country. It is incredible to have, I'll name a few names, you know, a few of the GOP elders this time around, including, frankly, Eric Metaxas and Gary Bauer and Jerry Falwell and others who have just puckered up to this one. I mean, it's incredible to me. And it is a moral, it is not just a moral character issue, although it is that. It is also, is a person qualified to be president of the United States? And it's abundantly clear to me that he is not. So, you know, this time around it's a little harder. It's a little harder to vote for the top of the ticket. People get emotional pretty quickly, and I'm sure all of you have very strong feelings about this one this time around. We're going to be fine. Our country's going to be fine. But I actually think one of the two options is pretty risky this time around. I mean, the markets could be highly affected. The careful peace, global balance that has been cultivated in the last 7 decades are highly vulnerable if one of the two candidates at the top of the ticket is elected, in my opinion. And that's a problem. That's a problem, you know, in my opinion, you know, kind of no matter what, but it's a particular problem for us as Christians if you have the right to vote and you choose to sit home. It is a bad call to sit home in this election. And anybody who disagrees, I'd love to talk rationally, not emotionally, with both mind and heart in view about why that's such a bad call. You know, you shared a lot of things, Matthew, that were really good, and I believe in all that stuff about the importance of erecting a community in the spirit of creation, fall, redemption, consummation. It's not just, conserving and redeeming, as you said. It's all four. It's creation, fall, redemption, consummation. And here we are, the joyous position in history of sitting between redemption and consummation and getting to lean forward as best we can, even when the light goes real dim and real dark. But the truth is, the light is always there, and the violin, as Rilke puts it, is always playing. And in this great country that we have, and now 140 democracies around the world, we need civic engagement that is principled, that is deeply biblical, that is Christian, that doesn't conflate the kingdom of this world with the kingdom of heaven, that doesn't say that you know, the body politic is my true home, my true identity, and I'm not part of the global brotherhood of believers. We are part of the global brotherhood of believers. We're part of the global brotherhood and sisterhood of believers. That means that our real identity is tied to people in sub-Saharan Africa and in Latin America and in Asia and in places where there are tongues of fire and miracles happening, and the weight of the church is there. And it's a great joy, not only as human beings who are made in the image of God, part of the global church, to be paying attention to that weight, that reality, but also to be citizens, even right here in our little country at home, especially because we happen to be the richest and wealthiest country with the highest powered military by a factor of 8 over any other country in the history in current history. So I think our moment is one to steward carefully. I've preached enough, but that's the gist of what I have to say.
Okay, thanks, Josh. You were actually a little under time there. So you both laid out a lot in those statements, and I want to try to come back and distill down what you said, and particularly highlight areas of both agreement as well as disagreement. So Josh, if I understood you correctly, you would affirm what Matthew had talked about in terms of our primary allegiance is still to God's kingdom. A secondary allegiance would be to whatever the citizenry that we're a part of, whether it be America or India or whatever the nation might be, that we have to somehow walk in a tension between those two. And what you would say is to, I don't want to put words in your mouth, correct me if I'm wrong, but to neglect our responsibilities and duties to our citizenry, to our particular domestic nation, is missing a component.
Yes.
It's a secondary component,
yes,
but it's still missing a component. Is that a fair distillation?
Yes, absolutely. I would say it this way. I think of it as having hats. And all of us in the room, first and foremost, if we're part of the kingdom of the Son, are a child of God first and foremost. That's our first hat. That's our first hat. After that, we're probably members of a family. You're a husband and a father of 10. Wow, bless you. And your wife. You know, you guys are, yeah, that's great. And you guys are secondarily part of a family. And third, you know, maybe, I don't know what it is, you're part of your local church, maybe. You could say that's next importance, family and church, that's way up there. I mean, some of you are giving 50 hours a week to your time here at Harvard University or time as undergrad, you know, high school. You're a student. That's a high identity as well. That's an important hat. But every one of us is also a member of nation, and therefore as a citizen, as a political citizen, which is part of who we are, I believe, in terms of identity, not merely a nice extra that we get to do on the side, but it's part of who we are. I don't know what the percentage breakdown is, but it's an essential hat that we are always wearing, whether we exercise it in the world or not. Our identity as a member of a political citizen, once you have an American citizenship card, you're a citizen here, or you could be in Ireland, or you could be in Madagascar. We are citizens. So either we exercise that muscle or we don't. It's part of our identity as I see it. And therefore, getting the order right is important. Eventually, you might say I'm a conservative or I'm a liberal or whatever. That's further down than the highest identities. But it is an identity and an aspect of who we are.
Okay. I was going to ask you, why is there a conflict? So within these different hats, these different
identities? It's very well stated. And here's where I would highlight the conflict. Let's just take our present climate, because that's where we're all at. Now, if I have a global brotherhood, my brothers exist in Syria, in Libya, in Gaza, in all over the place. Now, how do I next Tuesday go and wear my citizen hat and cast a vote for someone who is potentially, and in this case, in both cases, has avowed to drop bombs on my brothers in Gaza? How do I, as someone who's been told by Jesus, my first hat, that all of us recognize that's the primary responsibility that we have. Jesus makes the case that it's over family, it's over lands, it's over nation, it's over children. The primary responsibility that I have in my life is to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. And as a disciple, he's making claims on my life that it's my obligation to love my enemies and then go and elect a commander-in-chief who's going to destroy my enemies, who may not even be my enemies. In the case of World War II, you have Christian Germany fighting the Christian allies. If everyone had been putting on the right hat, if all of those people had been Christian indeed instead of Christian in name, how do you have a war between brothers? It doesn't exist. This highlights exactly the problem with divided allegiance, and why I would say that not only is it not a good idea to vote on Tuesday, but it's actually treason against the king to vote on Tuesday, because he has laid out a claim to responsibility in my life over exactly these kinds of issues. And either you have to have Jesus as king, or you elect a commander-in-chief that's going to run. We know in both of these cases, in huge areas of both of their platforms, are going to run directly oppositional to the law of my king. And this conflict seems irreconcilable. Not only that, but I'll leave it there, because there's a lot of other things
to go. I want to distill down. So basically, and to put it in a nutshell, you can't serve two masters.
That's right.
When
you'll either hate the one or love the other.
And you're saying that there's a conflict. There's an intrinsic conflict
between a commander-in-chief and a prince of peace.
Josh had said there's these different, we're in families, we're in schools, we're in countries. And correct me if I'm wrong, but you would say that some of those don't entail a conflict, and so therefore you can serve as a loyal
son. Absolutely. I can be a loyal father as a disciple of Jesus Christ. I cannot be a participant in war. I cannot be a participant in...
Why isn't it the case... Is it okay to do this?
Yeah, please. Yeah.
All right, so let's get into it a little bit. I mean, why isn't it the case that you can't simply say, okay, I'm not called to be a soldier. I'm not going to personally drop bombs in Syria. And let's just be careful here about enemies. I don't think we can know with any degree of certainty what Hillary is going to do when she is president, nor what hypothetically Donald Trump could theoretically do were he to become president, in terms of number of bombs dropped in, quote, Libya, Gaza, Syria, or other places around the world. We don't know, okay? There's a lot of things that can unfold. I don't understand why is it not possible to say, okay, I'm of Anabaptist persuasion, and therefore I won't fight in the military. And if there's a draft, which there won't be, but if there were, well, actually, if we get the wrong guy in there, who knows what's going to happen. If there were a draft, I will be a principled, conscientious objector, but I'm not going to. Why are you implicated by choosing, as it were, the lesser of two evils who will help keep us on the reservation by, theoretically again, her worst military decision?
So there's a lot of different answers to that question, but if we stay on point with the case at hand, there's not a president in my lifetime that hasn't dropped bombs somewhere in the world. They all do. That's their job. Remember, they're marshaling this military force that's 8 times greater than any other nation in the world. And that's not for show. They use it. They always use it. Every one of them uses it. There's not an example contrary to my life. So this isn't speculation. Mm-hmm. I know that the next president is going to drop bombs somewhere in the world. Now, if I go and I say, so if, for instance, the one vote, one election that I voted in was Bush Jr., the first election.
Senior.
No. Junior.
43.
Right. So when I voted in that election, I didn't hold a lot of these convictions as a brand new Christian. And there was a war that came from the, and I watched the horror that happened all over the world. And I couldn't escape the notion that I consented to that war. My name was used, my authority was given in consent to him persecuting that war. Because you can't separate the two. I know, you know, that the commander-in-chief is going to respond militarily to whatever he sees fit. That's his job. And the question of whether or not you can serve the Prince of Peace by electing the commander-in-chief, in my mind, looks like an irreconcilable conflict.
So what does Paul mean in saying that the sword is not born in vain?
Yeah, so I think, actually, let me cite someone here. Irenaeus, one of the Bishop of Lyons, he has this amazing thing that he says. He says, God imposed upon mankind the fear of man, for mankind did not acknowledge the fear of God. So he did this in order that being subjected to the authority of men and kept under restraining by their law, mankind might obtain some degree of justice. They might exercise natural forbearance through dread of the sword. Earthly rule, therefore, has been appointed by God for the benefit of the nations. This is so that under the fear of human rulers, men may not eat each other up like fishes. He goes on to talk about how our calling is in an entirely different vein, that we're called to the higher callings of the church, just like, you know, all of ancient civilizations always allowed their priests to forego those issues.
It's just that we live under the somewhat historically unparalleled blessing of peace and prosperity. And your wonderful school and family life and church life are able to flourish because of police officers and because of an international order that is preserved and protected in large part by the United States military, who keeps the seas free for trade to happen. See, I take a very different point of view. I think that the blessing of Romans 13 and what Paul means in saying that government does not bear the sword in vain is that we ought to respect those in authority. Mm-hmm. And in fact, we have to respect those in authority. And as Anabaptist as you want to be, if a police officer stops you on the street, you owe him respect. And if a police officer abuses that authority that he or she is temporarily given as a steward, we have a system called the rule of law that can hold that police officer accountable. And that is the beauty of the rule of law, which we are seeing exercised in our own little land in beautiful ways right now. So, you know, the rule of law is a gift. The fact that government bears the sword and has armed coercive power can either be a hostile threat, something to run away from, something to decry prophetically, as it were, or something to say, God in heaven, you have given us this gift. The rule of law will keep order, you know, will keep us on the reservation, will keep us able to be checked against our baser nature. And the truth of it is, read the Federalist Papers. I mean, the truth of it is, we have this baser nature, as you described in your opening remarks, and it's a gift to have, you know, the rule of law. It's a gift to have the sword.
Certainly agree with that.
Yeah. Well, and so the question is, you know, The famous question that was posed once in front of me in Eastern College was, if Hitler is marching toward you right now, what do? You roll over, you turn the other cheek? And that's a hard question to answer. What's your answer?
Well, the question is, where's our ultimate allegiance? I mean, who has the right to dictate that response? Who can inform my life in how to respond to Hitler marching towards me? Is it the state structure around me? Is it Caesar and his demands on my life? Or is it my King Jesus? The question is he a king? If he's the king and he says, love your enemies, in what context can I disobey him?
If a burglar breaks into my house tomorrow in Wisconsin, what is my duty?
Well, I think that I'm happy to answer that, but we're sidetracking to a different issue on non-resistance. We could have a discussion about non-resistance, but it will take us an entirely different way. What I'm more interested in is, how do we deal with participation in the civil structure? How do we deal with the conflict between the hats of citizen and Christian? And there is an implicit, every Christian going to the polls on Tuesday knows there's a conflict. Every Christian is wrestling. Maybe I believe in Mr. Trump's economic policy. Maybe I don't. But I think he's going to stop immigration, preserve law in that regard. But he's also a philanderer and a wicked man in whatever personal aspects. Maybe I prefer Mrs. Clinton's economic policy. But I know what's going to happen in the Supreme Court nominations that come up under her. I know what's going to happen in her avowed military policies. Where do you pick the line? Mr. Trump says he's open to the idea of dropping nuclear weapons in the Middle East. He wants to torture the families of terrorists. Mrs. Clinton, we know, is a supporter of Planned Parenthood. You have an option as a Christian. I'm voting on Tuesday for death or death. Which death do you want? Which death is which representative of a system of death and coercion is less
and
deadly?
You quoted Irenaeus earlier, and I'd like to offer one probably familiar to you, to all of us, quote from him before we go to the, I know you're wanting to go to the audience. But, you know, Irenaeus famously said that the glory of God is, you know this?
Mm-mm.
The glory of God is the human person fully alive. The glory of God is the human person fully alive.
Mm-hmm.
That ought, in my view, as Christians, to be our civic end, to see more people flourishing. How do people flourish? Faith, family, community, and work. Faith, family, community, and work. And the sociologist will back that up, and I'll be happy. So we need meaningful work in our lives. We all need to be needed. That's why we need meaningful work. And there's a whole group of people this election cycle who is disconnected from work in the labor force right now, three times as many as in 1950. That's a big problem for us. That's a big part of Trump's support for us to deal with when it comes to the work of reconciliation and rebuilding, which is what we'll need to do, by the way, starting November 9th, and frankly, starting this morning. That's the job, is to reconcile. Listen, we got two candidates that have really kind of pulled us this way a little bit, and we need to do more reconciliation. And there's a great opportunity for all of us as Christians, believers, and as citizens in the country. There really is. It's a great time to be alive. It's going to be a really tough election, and we're going to get through it. And then there's going to be a concession speech, and we're going to get. But the point is, Irenaeus wants the glory of God to come in the world, and so do we, which is human flourishing. And that means that, you know, you have to choose between, quote, death and death. Well, all right, fine. Which death is worse? It's pretty obvious. To me, it's pretty obvious. And it's not to
Why is it obvious?
Because neither of these next two presidential candidates is going to change Roe v. Wade in the next 4 years. That's why. And because just look at the legacy of the last four Republican presidents. It hasn't changed yet. I understand the argument that the next justice is really important, or the next two justices, and there probably will be two appointments. You know, fine. Play the long game, okay? Don't play the short game. It never works to try to change culture out of the law. If you have political law and you dominantly rule over a people group with something that they don't want, eventually the culture still wins. So in 2085, even if Donald Trump gets elected and does what he says, which is very unlikely, that he actually appoints two pro-life justices and they change the law on Roe v. Wade and we can some of us, some people would celebrate that for a short time. It won't win unless the culture changes. Religious liberty is a big deal. Marriage, life, these are big deals. I agree with you. And look, I'm not inclined to vote the lever for Hillary Clinton. But you know what? This time around, I'm more inclined to vote for her than the other guy. And I'll tell you why. Because what you say about nuclear bombs, I mean, I don't think he'll really do it, but it's a threat. Destabilizing the global trade reality of our world and having the markets come unraveled could happen in the next 4 years, in my view, as I understand this man. And, you know, this idea that Muslims should be kept out, this idea that we should build a big wall and send 14 or 15 million people, round them up in buses, give me a break. It's 2016. Give me a break. Like, we got past that about 40 years ago. And if you want to turn back the clock and have a fear-based, you know, ignorant to the reality of trade, political, economic platform, then woe is us, and we deserve all the hurt that's going to come from it. You know, listen, we'll have a tough several years, 4 years. I think we'll get through this election just fine. It'll hurt a little bit. We'll get through it just fine. I have a sense of who's going to win, and I can talk about that later. But as Christian citizens, it is not satisfactory to sit back and say, I wash my hands of it all. I'll have communion in my home. I don't mean to be disrespectful, but as if it's not acceptable.
I think that's an important issue. Whether or not non-participation in civil government, as I advocate it, as we advocate it in our fellowship, is abdication. Whether it's isolationism, whether it's disappearing into the woods mm-hmm. and letting the world burn. It's actually the opposite.
Okay.
What we advocate is that there is a notion that the democracy has become the sacred cow of American evangelicalism, that our American exceptionalism and all the things that go along with that, to our ears, sound exactly like Roman exceptionalism. We hear the same language being said in Caesar's court in the first, second, and third century. The same talk about the rule of law, the same talk about the glory of the Senate, the same talk about how valuable the empire is to humanity and how it's preserving a course for the enlightenment of all the people and the ennoblement of all the poor. All of this same discussion has been had millennia ago in their context. We're men stuck in this context. Are we falling to prey to the same notions of our own exceptionalism? And if there's a potential for that, and I think there is a large potential for that, what is the real hope of the poor? What is the real hope of the world? I would say that the darkness of this election cycle is not an anomaly, that this is the current state of a trend that is going to continue. We know that when we look at post-First War Germany, the factionalization of political parties, there's dozens and dozens of political parties, and they factionalize over time into where they galvanize into two extremes where you have the Bolsheviks on one hand and the fascists on the other. And that's the only options left. And how do we not see the same parallels in our own day? That we have this same construct being set up of polarization. It's not a function of this election cycle. It's a function of our system. And what that's highlighting is that this is not the answer for man. The American exceptionalism mentality is not the key. The church being faithful to her call and to her ministry, that's the light, not democracy. Mm-hmm. Savior, the state is not the savior. Christ is the savior.
I share the part about the value of us as believers, as citizens, being humble, being steady, plodding along, being servants as we lead. And also, frankly, love of country, a posture of humility, not a posture of top-down dominance. And we're invited into that, and it'll be great to have a conversation about it.
So I want to go through a bunch of hopefully quick questions that I'd love to hear responses from both of you on, and you're allowed to respond first. But Josh made a point there that I don't think we've touched on, which is, and I'll say it in different words, but I think it's a fair summary, this notion that if we're benefiting from the rule of law and all of the advances that Josh alluded to there, doesn't it feel like the position you adopted? It's almost like being a mooch. Mm-hmm. You're willing to accept all the benefits that come from government, but at the same time, you don't want to contribute in a civic way to the advancement of government. How would you respond to that?
Yeah, I would have three main answers to that. One is that we do partake in our civic responsibilities. Our king has commanded us to pay taxes for the sake of the people around us, not because out of some sense of obligation, but because we want to, as travelers and sojourners, as strangers in this country, we want to not offend anyone. That's a root of our civic responsibility. Secondly, our civic responsibility comes in personal lives. Our civic responsibility comes from actually making impact in our neighborhoods, actually caring for the people around us, actually reaching out to people that are in jeopardy of being in need of an abortion. That's a notion of civic responsibility. And lastly, I would say that as we understand the function of state, that the law is for the lawless, we aren't under obligation to that. We don't have a need for Caesar to tell us not to kill people. Our people do not need the law, the policeman to tell us not to drive recklessly, not to commit assault and robbery and all these things. Those are not things that we are in need of. They are things that society is in need of, but we as the people of Jesus have been called out of that order, and we're not beholden to it because we have a higher calling. Those laws are in place for people that are not us. They're in place for people who are in risk of committing assault, of acting dangerously in society. We are not those people. So our civic responsibility is performed in religious obligation to our king, who happens to align his interests with those civic responsibilities. But the other version of civic responsibility that says kill your enemies, participate in immorality, whatever those cases may be, in the case of the early church, in partaking in civil religious affairs, all those things are abdicated, and we say that's not our responsibility. So we drive down the roads that are paved by the government, and we pay for the roads that are paved by the government. So we're not abdicating any responsibility. We're partaking in society as healthy, fruitful members, and we're, like Justin says, we are good for you. We are good for your society. We're helping Rome by being the people that we are.
Just a word of caution. I would just say it's important for all of us to remember, even as we're sitting at these tables, that we sit on the shoulders of giants. None of us in this room who are Harvard students have paid for our education. None of us in this room have paid for our tuition. There are people, many of them living, many of them not living anymore, who have made this possible. And frankly, on the paving of roads, there are people who are wealthier than us, who have paid a percentage of their taxes, who have made this possible. And it's glorious of the privilege that we have to be a part of this body politic for all of its problems. But I do think it is a mistake to suppose somehow that we're part of an elevated order not really needing or subject to the laws of the land, because if we get in an accident, we're going to need those paramedics. And if we get pulled over by a police officer, we're going to need to pay that ticket. And, you know, we are actually subject to the laws of this land, citizens of heaven that we are.
Let me turn to a different topic that I wanted to ask you about, Josh. So one of the intrinsic difficulties that people have had in this election that we've touched on is these competing value claims. So on the one side, many people would say you're voting for abortion. The other side, people would say you're voting for reckless policies in a host of manners. And this is why there's tremendous division. You don't see a unified sort of, in the evangelical churches at least, everyone saying this is the candidate or this is the candidate, because there's such a difficulty in the calculus of knowing how to weigh these competing value claims. How do you weigh them? What is the way that one comes to a point where you can vote and keep a clean conscience when you pull the lever on Tuesday if you were to vote?
Yeah. Pray, talk with your family, go vote on Tuesday morning, vote your conscience, come home. Don't take a shower afterwards.
Okay. So there's not a framework that you would offer. It's simply an individualistic weighing that would happen. So for some people who think abortion is the most important issue, you would say that's fine. For other people that think that trade
I like what Matthew said earlier about the rain falling on the just and the unjust alike, about the wheat and the tares growing up side by side at this point in human history. Listen, at this point in redemptive history, that's the way it works. We got the rain falling on the just and the unjust alike, and we got the wheat and the tares growing up side by side. And so in terms of a framework, I would just say, the idea of a public legal order that's different than Christian morality is a fact. It's just the law of the land. And so it becomes possible, in my view, to support a candidate who has a different point of view morally on a number of issues because the public legal order that that candidate would help to advance in the world that we're going to inhabit and swim in for the next 4 or 8 years, you know, is going to be better than the alternative. And that's just, you know, public legal order is a certain kind of morality. It's not relativism to say if you're for gay marriage and I'm not for gay marriage and I vote for you that I've done a sin. It's silly to think that, in my opinion.
Okay. Matthew, question for you. Josh had touched on this, but the notion that we enjoy especially religious liberties about the freedom to worship, the freedom to share the gospel, all those kinds of things, which are, especially in the case of the United States, are entrenched in the documents themselves, and we have the opportunity to affirm in various ways in the ballot box. Doesn't it feel like the position that you've taken is, in a sense, undercutting those very liberties itself and cutting against the gospel and the ability of the gospel to go forward?
In not supporting and endorsing the notions of liberty that are entrenched in
right.
American civil structures.
That's right.
Yeah, it's an interesting question. I think that from my view, looking at the long range of the church and where she came from, the presumption of those religious freedoms are never something that was a plan for the church. In fact, we have Tertullian saying the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the gospel. If we joined the church under a crucified Jesus telling us to take up crosses daily and follow him, if he told us that if you seek to gain your life, you'll lose it, when he tells us that what is in store for us via the apostle, all who live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution, to try to spend my time, energy, and attention in getting rid of that potential for having to bear a cross does not seem like a valid discharge of a Christian duty. If those things happen to be here, we happen to enjoy them. If they don't, we don't. What we know from history is that when the church has not enjoyed those freedoms is when she's been particularly successful as far as the gospel is concerned. Justin Martyr watches the Christians die in the common. And he says, what is it about those people that they're willing to die so boldly? Why is their death so precious? Why do they go to their graves blessing those that hate them? And this is the catalyst for why people are interested in the gospel. Now, I'm not, that same persecuted church says we're not courting persecution. We're not looking for it, but neither are we running from it. And where we look at the world today, where we find the most successful churches doing the most dramatic work for the gospel and seeing the tongues of fire is in places where it's under suppression and under danger. So the ultimate fear is not the loss of religious liberty. The ultimate fear is not being effective at the gospel and our real job on earth.
Question for you, Josh. So one of the things that most ethicists and people would agree with, this was really highlighted in the Nuremberg trials, was this notion that if your superior officer tells you to do something that you believe is wrong, in this case it was killing Jews there, you're not allowed to do that. And you'll be held culpable if you're the person who pulls the lever. You can't just say, oh, my commanding officer told me to do that. In this case, with the election, some set of laws will ultimately manifest there. Is participation, in a sense, acquiescing to the system and binding yourself to the system such that you agree with its results? I.e., if a person happens to care about, say, abortion, and they vote against it, but yet they say, as the laws unfold, abortion is the rule of the land, and now you're in a position where you have to, say, as a judge or in a variety of capacities, enforce that, which is the law of the land, which you have acquiesced to. Haven't you then put yourself in a moral quandary that isn't so different than, for example, that issue that I mentioned with the Nuremberg trials?
Yeah, I just said the great thing about our amazing democracy and the reality of liberty that we all have in this room is that we don't have to accept the premise of the question exactly as it's delivered. And so the The reality is that civic participation is not about Tuesday morning. If you reduce civic participation to Tuesday morning, oh my goodness, what are you doing for 4 years? I mean, the joy of democracy is that we get to be involved in shaping our country. That's true whether you're an elected office or whether you're a student or whether you're a church worker or whether you're any of many things, a chaplain. The point, civic participation and being a part of this democracy means we own it. And so, you know, I'd say, sure, for the 12 seconds you actually pull the lever and turn in your card on Tuesday morning, that's an important question. But the reality is, what are you doing about that issue? If you are pro-life, what are you doing with your friends or your church or whatever else to serve people who are in need in a vulnerable spot in their life? Or when it comes to your own questions of sexual morality? Think about it then. That's when you should think about that question. Voting for a candidate, it's such a minor part of citizenship. It's like less than 1%, I think. I mean, it's important, but it's like less than 1%. So citizenship, especially at the Kennedy School, is about your life. What you're going to do with your life. Are you going to go run for public office? Or are you going to take the easy way out and go to Wall Street? You know, are you going to take a consultant job and make $80,000 a year? Or are you going to go work for $45,000 a year at your first job out of HKS? You know what? I hope there's somebody in this room who runs for office at $45,000 and gets their money paid back from the Kennedy School for that amazing program. We need people to run for office in this room who are awesome. So do it, you know? Don't sit on the sidelines. And, you know, that's the same thing on the Christians involved in politics. It's just like, you know, you can say, listen, that our country and your children's future and my children's future will be shaped by people who are part of the next administration and the one that follow and the one that follow and the one that follows that. Let's start thinking about 2062 and 2036. Those are important elections for the digital age people. And play the long game and don't play the short game. So great question. I just say, look, civic participation is a heck of a lot more than voting.
Okay. Two more questions, then I'm going to open it up for audience questions. Matthew, this question's for you. There are actually a number of examples in the Bible, Joseph, Daniel, who were involved in governments in some way. They had fairly important roles there. In modern history, someone might point to Wilberforce as a positive example of someone who helped overthrow slavery. How do you discount or how do you process those examples?
So the inauguration of Jesus as king is a vital hermeneutic for understanding the Old Testament versus the New Testament, where the gospel dispensation fits in with Jesus coming in and being a king for a new people as Messiah is a huge piece to the puzzle of how we look at Abraham or Joseph or Daniel in their involvement with the structures around them. You know, because Jesus before Pilate says, I hear you're the king of the Jews. And he says, are you a king? Pilate says. And he says, for this cause was I born, but now is my kingdom not from hence. So he's inaugurating a kingdom as a political leader that can't be overemphasized. How do we look at current examples like Wilberforce and his connection to abolition in England? The question is, what enables Wilberforce to do what he does? And what we know from the abolition movement, which is dear to the heart of the Christian community, is that the grassroots movements of boycotting, of not putting sugar in your tea because it comes from the slave trade, the populist movement of moral influence of the church in society is actually what makes the difference. And then there's a platform within the civil structure where that makes sense. But without the people spreading the influence, there's a quote, and I think it's by Clement. He says, the church is to the world what the conscience is to the body. And that's a beautiful way to understand our role. See, your conscience, it can't force you. It has no club. It has nothing that can force your behavior. But neither can you stop it. You can't get away from it. It's persistent. It's there when you lay on your bed at night. It's there when you look at yourself in the mirror. Your conscience is the unwavering witness of who you really are. And that's the legitimate moral, civil function of the church and society. And when the church has forsaken that and exchanged it for political influence and power, she's actually lost her real influence in society. And we see that all around us today. in what the evangelical church and her witness means to the American culture at large is exactly proportional to how she's exchanged her influence for political influence.
Last question, and this is for Josh, and then we'll take questions. One of the things that Matthew had mentioned was when Jesus came, there was this expectation that he would be the conquering ruler, the one who would overthrow Rome by might, potentially by politics. And he surprised everyone. He surprised everyone by being the servant who washed feet. And there's something continually you see in the New Testament, the gospel, where it's surprising. Jesus says, you know, the Gentiles do it a certain way. It's not going to be so among you. And this upside down value set, I think most people would agree, permeates most of the New Testament, where a lot of our sort of natural logic is upended. There's many passages that I think we could point to there. How would you respond to the notion that what you've advocated with sort of engagement is basically what everybody does? That's how the nations do it. And that the surprise of the gospel, this service under, this doing things completely differently, is lost in all of this. And it becomes, as Matthew had mentioned, it becomes something where it feels like it's Christians trying to, especially in a majority Christian country, impose their will on others as opposed to being those who are the servants. Mm-hmm.
I think the gospel sets us as believers free from the prisons of various institutional settings. You know, if you're in Washington, D.C., and you go into a room, people pretty quickly figure out whether you're a Republican or a Democrat and where your true allegiances are, and if you're one of us, then you're safe, and if you're not, then you're not. And as believers, we're set free from that. We're invited into the kind of liberty where we can have an identity that's not merely of this world, or certainly not of a political party, as was said on the lovely NPR piece that you played. We appreciate it. That's an interesting comment to think about, you know, that we have certain priorities that are aligned with this team, and we have certain priorities that are aligned with this team, and it kind of depends from time to time. We're a little bit more purple, probably. I don't know exactly. But I would say that in terms of the surprises, what an opportunity this election is. It's been, I've been wrestling with it a lot because it's felt like a dark one. Times felt a little dark. It's just so eerie that it's real. On the other hand, it's an opportunity for us as believers not only to come, forward and writing great op-eds on November 9th with fresh perspective and thinking ahead about parties and all kinds of opportunities that there are. You know, not only that, but also to call a spade a spade. I mean, what an eerie time this is. I had one quote, if you permit. Russell Moore gave a speech last week in New York to the First Things, and it was a lovely speech. Actually, if there was one thing I would recommend, I would recommend reading Russell Moore's Erasmus lecture called Can the Religious Right Be Saved? And he surprised me. His quote was, if we define religious right in terms of professional, political, activist gatekeepers, then yes, there's a problem. The religious right establishment is one big Wittenberg door with an ever-expanding target where a nail should be. That movement's institutional matrix seems increasingly exhausted, resentful, and at war with its own future. The internal family conversations about the brokenness of these movements and the institutions were kept quiet, waiting for the inevitable generational transfers that could allow new starts. But those internal conversations were, like a WikiLeaks email, made cringingly public by the 2016 presidential campaign and the scandalous role of the institutional religious right in it. That is not a crisis, that is an opportunity.
Questions? Zach.
My question is for you, Matt. You play out a narrative in World War II where like, if Christians adopted this narrative, then they wouldn't be fighting each other. I'd like to see, like, you check the outcome of, like, if all Christians didn't participate in politics, like, what does that look like in 50 years? And let's say, do the politicians, would they simply hand over the reins to somebody else who would then willingly take them? And I'm just curious as to what that would be.
Yeah, let me repeat the question. So the question is if there is a broader movement of Christians not voting, not serving in elected office, what are the implications of that? Who's in charge? How does that handoff work? And what does the world look like in a few years?
years?
I think that is one of the key questions to this whole subject of what actually are we advocating for what the world looks like under this kind of kingship leadership of Jesus in real political terms. And what I would say is, in answer to that question is, think about what's being invested in the political process vis-a-vis the church. How much money, time, and energy is being spent on the behalf of the church for her political interests in society? I mean, are we overstating it to say billions of dollars and thousands and thousands and thousands of hours of time and energy? If you take that and take those billions of dollars and take those thousands of hours of time and energy and passion and put them into the things that the King Jesus says to invest in, put them into caring for the poor, put them into making difference in your neighborhood, put them into the church being the church, put them into Christian community, invest those resources in the real stated goals of the Church of Jesus Christ and create the society that he intended, then what does the world look at the church as? And which of those two things is of greater value to God and to my fellow man? If all the, I don't know how many, what the statistic is, 30 million Christians in America are involving their lives, well, what did Barna say? 73% of Americans. Let's just say those people are really Christians. Take this view, and 73% of America invest your time, energy, resource, and attention into the goals and ambitions of King Jesus in this country, what does that look like? And how much more valuable is that than what we've gotten out of the last 36 years of the moral majority in our political campaigning on behalf of evangelical interests? And I dare say that the value of the church being the church and really representing a real living Savior in a body of people functioning in living representative ways in the neighborhoods where people live, that really is what makes a difference. And that's what really will have a difference in the society at large. That's really what's going to change people's perspective on abortion. That's really what's going to inform foreign diplomacy and who we're fighting at and where the people are that are going to fight these wars. That's the real difference to be made.
Question over here, Kojo.
Thank you guys so much for sitting in this debate. Thanks to Matthew and Josh and Matthew for organizing it. Kind of as a follow-up to that question, do you think there are times where our involvement in the political sphere actually fulfills some of the obligations that we have that Jesus commands of us? So I think of examples like my family and I are from Ghana. Mm-hmm. We moved here like in the mid-90s. And if we moved here like 50 years earlier, like I wouldn't have drunk out the same water fountain as either of you guys. Or gone to the same schools or read the same books, like my life would have been like drastically different. And so I think a lot of about like the things that actually made that possible, like the basic level of political involvement that people like Dr. King and others mm-hmm. had, like motivating protests and stuff like that. And that has like reaped amazing and wonderful benefits. So I'm wondering if there are some examples where political involvement, at least at some level, actually does fulfill some of the callings that are being made. So like more practically, would Dr. King like be like disavowing his allegiance to Jesus mm-hmm. by deciding to like march on Washington and get sent to jail mm-hmm. and eventually getting all these rights for people who like otherwise wouldn't have them?
Wow, beautiful question.
It is a beautiful question.
Let me know when you run for office. I'll campaign for you.
There's a narrative around the sacredness of voting that has been incredibly influential in especially the civil rights movement in America. But I think it's worth questioning the narrative a little bit. What we see in a few examples, and this is spelled out very well, I think, in a little book called Electing Not to Vote. It's a series of essays. And in one of those essays, the notion of what happens in regards to the right to vote, especially regarding the civil rights movement and later in the anti-war movement when the voting age was changed to 18, in both of those cases, the right to vote was used to actually quiet the masses and dispel civil discontent with structures that really were oppressive. And so what you find is that as rights are granted from from the ruling class in America, and given out because that they're really given out not to empower those people, but to quiet the problems. And we find that, so in the case of the anti-war movement, when the Senate is debating whether or not to drop the voting age to 18, this is implicitly a part of the reason. Because the student activism movements will lose their power if we give people the right to vote. In other words, if we vent this steam of a real evil in the world that people are having activist issues about, people are out in the street saying this is wrong, we can't do this, they're upsetting society, they're crashing into the status quo. If we give them a channel to vent that steam into the political process, we can quiet the problem. And that really is what happens, because as civil rights turns into voting rights, it does quiet the civil discontent. And the next decade of laws that are passed are not amenable, by and large, to the black community. It does quiet the problem, but it doesn't help the neighborhoods. We still have the war on drugs perpetrated through the 80s and the 70s. We still have the problems in urban environments with poor blacks. The issues that were at the core of what Mr. King was trying to fix, the real social ills of the black communities, were not addressed in voting rights. They were addressed in local communities.
Yes, if I could just push back on that a little bit.
Sure.
That's a great idea. Like, even if you pluck voting out of it, is it, like I imagine with Dr. King, is it a good idea for us to protest, not so people can have voting rights, because that's maybe a secondary issue, so that like little black boys can read out of the same textbooks as like little white girls, so that like people who look like me can drink out of the same water fountain?
Absolutely.
Look like you. Does it matter that he's involved in politics at some basic level to fix those issues separate from things like voting and like more rights to more political participation?
Yeah, I think that
the answer is just yes. It's not all, it's not all these words. The actual truth is the answer is yes. And your Christian identity can be advanced by political engagement. Your Christian identity can be advanced by public engagement, by civic engagement. You know, part of who we are as Christians and as saints is citizens. And that citizenship is not reducible to some other world, because it's this world that God is going to redeem once and for all in not so very long. My view is what you said about Dr. King, not Mr. King, Dr. King, is exactly right. And, you know, read David Brooks' new book, On the Road to Character. It talks about a whole bunch of different people, Dorothy Day, people who worked to win women's suffrage, who did out of Christian faith motivation, out of moral faith-shaped, religiously-shaped, in a word, yes.
I agree that the church is political, and that notion of the church being the conscience of the world should be speaking in civil rights issues, should be speaking in anti-war issues, should be speaking about what is moral and right in society at large. And there is a great role for the church to fulfill in that. But I would push back in that Philippians is very clear where our citizenship is. That our citizenship is not in America. Our citizenship is in heaven. Mm-hmm. And this divided allegiance is a real question that the church has to deal with.
Absolutely agree with that. And, you know, at the same time, you know, Calvin, all of life is to be lived unto the Lord. All of life is to be lived unto the Lord. My kingdom is not of this world. Absolutely right. And heaven is not my home. Also absolutely right. What does that mean when Paul Marshall says heaven is not my home? Look, it's late in the day, people are hungry, ready for lunch. But I would just say, you know, as a closing comment, Washington, the United States of America, will be shaped by your fellow citizens. You can be a part of it. I think most of you will be a part of it. Or you can sit on the sidelines. The choice is yours. It's a gloriously free country. On Tuesday morning, you can go vote. You can stay home. It's your choice. It's a gloriously free country still, just barely. And we're going to make it. But the reality is that there was a little alarm going off when we were first talking. I don't know if you heard that softly in the background there. There's an alarm going off. And I think it's a good time to remember that and to be careful on Tuesday.
Closing comment, Matthew?
Yeah, I think this notion of what the church's real function in the world is what's at question. There are a few main reasons why I would advocate that the church stay home on Tuesday. I think that we have to keep our focus on what our King has told us to do in the world around us. That this notion of kingdoms is inviable for a Christian, that we have to have a political reality that the church is the nation of Jesus in all the earth, in every nation, and that my allegiance is there, not specifically to America. Secondly, an issue that I think is of supreme importance that we haven't even addressed yet is that this notion that the state structure's currency is coercion is tied up in democracy. We don't escape that because we have a democratic republic. When I go and pull a lever, whether it's for a candidate or for some statute or for a tax measure, what I am saying at the end of the day is that I am giving my voice of authority, my personhood, in support of this notion that the government, at the end of the day, is going to use its guns, its sword, to force my neighbor to do something that he may not agree with. That coercion is what's at the bottom of the ballot box. That my consent to the system is saying that I am willing to force my neighbor. If I'm against gay marriage, I'm willing to use the government guns to force my neighbor not to marry a man. If I'm against abortion, that I'm willing to use the government's guns to force women not to have abortion. If I'm against, whatever I'm against, if I want to have a library downtown, I'm willing to use the government's guns to force my neighbors to shell out for a library. That's what's at the bottom of the ballot box. And that's what's purely and patently un-Christians about the notions.
Well, this has been a very stimulating discussion. I'm sure we can continue this much more. Let's end. Let's thank our panelists here. And then they'll be around for some time. I hope you can stay around and take more questions and continue the dialogue. Thanks for coming.